Thank you, Chris, for that introduction, and thank you to all of you for wanting to be here this morning, and thank you for the opportunity to speak about my PhD project. So I thought I'd just sort of flag what I'm going to speak about today. So I'm going to speak a little bit about who I am, how I've come to my PhD project, the rationale for the international collaboration, a little bit about my time overseas, and also plans for the future. So as Chris mentioned earlier, I'm actually a clinician. I'm a pediatric allergist and immunologist. I did my training at the Royal Children's Hospital down in Melbourne and also at Sydney Children's Hospital just up the road in Randwick. And while I was at Sydney Children's Hospital, I was fortunate to look after a very special little boy called Alan, who some of you may have heard about Alan's story through the Garvan and through the press. So when I was looking after him, Alan was a very, very sick little boy. He'd been in and out of hospital his entire life, particularly with low blood cell counts, with recurrent infections, with quite severe diarrhea. And when I was looking after him in 2015, he was in hospital for months on end, in and out of the ICU, with really just terrible diarrhea. Also quite enlarged lymph nodes, and despite all our sort of standard medical tests that we did, we couldn't get to the bottom of what was actually causing his symptoms. And so eventually, through the Garvan Institute, Alan underwent genetic testing, which found that he had mutations in the gene called LRBA, which I'll talk about a little bit later. Quite serendipitously, around the same time, a study had been published that showed that a drug called abatacept was actually quite effective for patients with LRBA syndrome. And so we got the genetic diagnosis and also this paper about this new drug. It all sort of happened at the same time, and we started Alan on abatacept, and he responded very well. So within the first few weeks, his blood cell count started to improve, and then steadily with higher doses of the drug, his diarrhea really settled, and now he's a well little boy, attends school every day, you know, he's not in and out of hospital anymore, and has a much improved quality of life. So at the time, I knew I wanted to do a PhD, and I thought, why not study LRBA? It was a disease that had only been described in 2012, so it's quite new. And there was, suffice to say, a lot we didn't know about this disease. So what is LRBA? So that's the actual definition. You don't need to remember that. There's no quiz at the end. I still find it hard to say myself sometimes. But basically, it's a genetic disease. It's a gene that's found on chromosome number 4. It's an autosomal recessive disease, which means that you need two copies of the disease, one inherited from mum, one inherited from dad, to actually be sick. And mum and dad, as carriers, with just one copy of the mutant gene are actually healthy, so they wouldn't necessarily even know that they carry this gene, but their children are at risk of developing this disease. So what's interesting about LRBA deficiency is that it's not only an immune deficiency, so children get recurrent infections, particularly pneumonia, ear infections, but they also suffer from immune dysregulation, which is when the immune system, instead of just attacking foreign species like viruses and bacteria or cancers, which is what it's supposed to do, also starts to attack its own body, its own host. And so we see features of autoimmunity in this disease as well. So typical features are infections, anemia, low platelet counts that leads to easy bruising and bleeding, very severe diarrhea and enlarged lymph nodes. But what's also interesting is there's a really great spectrum of disease manifestations amongst patients with this disease, even amongst patients with the same mutations, even siblings with the same mutations have quite different features, and we don't understand why that is. And even though abatacept is a very promising therapy for this disease and helps patients like Alan, it's not actually a cure. And the only real cure that we have at the moment is a bone marrow transplant, which, you know, is not a procedure that you undertake lightly because it has its own risks. So with that in mind, I thought, okay, I want to do this PhD, I want to study LRBA, but we had a problem. And that was that, as far as I'm aware to date, Alan is still the only patient with this disease in Australia. And that's actually not a problem for Australia. It's great that we don't have a lot of people with these sorts of diseases, but for the sake of my PhD, I needed to find a few more patients. So how did I do that? So, as I mentioned earlier, LRBA is an autosomal recessive disease. So it's much, those sorts of diseases, which we see a lot of in primary immune deficiency, are much more common in the Middle East. And that's because consanguinity or marriage within the family is a much more common cultural practice, particularly cousin marriage. I know in an Australian context, sometimes people feel like that's a maybe controversial thing to say, but really in the Middle East, it's just a very common cultural practice. It keeps wealth within the family, dowry, those sorts of things. And over there, when you ask people, parents of a sick child, if they're cousins, like no one really bats an eyelid and it's not considered an offensive question. So knowing that, I guess a bit more explanation about who I am. I was actually born in Israel. My family moved to Australia when I was 3, and I've always grown up feeling a bit Israeli, I guess you could say. I knew that in Israel there were a lot of large centres caring for these sorts of children. They had a lot of patients with these sorts of diseases. So I got in contact with Professor Polina Stepensky, who is a bone marrow transplanter who heads the, she's the director of the bone marrow transplant team at Hadassah Medical Center, which is in the hills just outside Jerusalem. Hadassah has really been a leader in Israel and in the world in diagnosing children with these sorts of genetic disorders. Part of that is because it is there is a more consanguineous population, so finding these genetic disorders is easier. And also it's a world leader in bone marrow transplant expertise. But what they have in patient numbers and genetic and strength in genetic diagnosis, they lack in the ability to perform a lot of immunodiagnostics. And that's where the collaboration with wanting to work with Garvan came in, because Garvan, as you've heard today, has amazing immunodiagnostic facilities and is really a world leader in that sense. But sort of in Australia, we lack those sorts of patients. So trying to bring together those two strengths of Hadassah and of the Garvan, I spoke to Professor Stepensky and my supervisor here at Garvan, Professor Stuart Tangy, about trying to make this happen as a collaboration. Fortunately, they were quite excited by the possibility and said, yeah, let's try and do this. So off I went from Australia over to the Middle East. And then I started trying to recruit patients. And as you can imagine, probably from watching the news, that in that sort of context, it's not so easy. So most of the patients are from the Palestinian Authority and from the Gaza Strip, so West Bank and Gaza Strip, and not from within Israel itself. So managing issues around border crossings, language difficulties, you know, patients not always being able to get to the hospital, you know, every month for their regular transfusion the way that they could potentially come to Sydney Children's Hospital. Oftentimes children would arrive to the hospital alone, you know, how do we care for them? And it really wouldn't have been possible without an amazing team that works together at Hadassah, and I just wanted to give them a little bit of a shout out, because behind all of this research is really a lot of people trying to make it happen. Despite how things look in the news, this team is really quite an inspiring example of people working together from different sides of the border, different religions, different backgrounds, to really try and help these children. And so these are just some of the administrative staff, doctors, nurses, lab staff that all help make this project possible. So all in all, we've recruited 19 patients over in Israel from 9 different families with 7 different gene mutations. So they're in addition to Alan. So we have a cohort of 20, which, you know, when you think about breast cancer, lung cancer, 20 doesn't sound like a lot. But the largest case series of patients for this disease had 23 patients sourced from all over the world. So 20 from essentially 2 centres is a lot. And what's really exciting about it is that we have a range of different mutations in this gene that we can study, and within some of those families there are multiple affected siblings. So one particular family The eldest brother has already undergone bone marrow transplant because he was the sickest. The youngest is sick but currently maintained on more conventional therapy. And the middle brother has no clinical features of the disease despite carrying the mutation. And we don't understand why that is. And having access to these patients really enables us to try and understand that better. So four patients have been started on the targeted therapy on abatacept, and six patients have undergone bone marrow transplantation. I've collected about 600 samples. I didn't poke these patients 600 times, but just, you know, collecting blood samples and spinning them down to hold their cells, serum, other tissue samples that we can now study. And the advantage of actually being there in the hospital with these patients is that I was able to follow them clinically. So I knew, for example, oh, this patient's been stable for 6 months and suddenly they're anemic, or suddenly their platelets have dropped. Why has that happened? So storing samples from those key time points to help us understand in a more dynamic way what exactly is happening. So now that I'm back here at Garvan, the next phase of the project is doing a lot of flow cytometry, so really looking at those cells, what are their numbers, what are they doing, before patients were started on treatment, after they were started on treatment, so either abatacept, steroids, or other treatments that we have, and also post bone marrow transplantation to look at how the immune system reconstitutes as these patients are cured. So we're targeting our investigations based on the patient's clinical features, and also a part of this project falls under the umbrella of the Garvan-Weizmann collaboration, which is really exciting, where we're hoping to do some single-cell RNA sequencing, which I guess is sort of that smoothie to fruit salad idea that was spoken about earlier. And I guess this project is an example of really bringing together patients and the lab, even if they are quite far apart. And, you know, these days in research, the term translational research is very much a buzz term. You know, how do we really go from patients back to the lab and study things that are then relevant directly to patients? So sort of going from patient to lab and back to patient again. Using genetics and various other research methodologies. And I guess to me, translational research is really a lot more these people, who are some of the patients that I've recruited from my study, all of whom were happy for me to share their photos. So the two on your left, two patients that have undergone bone marrow transplant, so before and after. The boy in the middle is it's a picture from during his transplant, and he's doing well now as well. And the other two are just two brothers who also have this disease that have been recruited to the study. So I guess I just wanted to say thank you, first of all, to all of you for coming today, to my supervisors for letting me go on this slightly unusual journey. First and foremost, really, to the patients and their families for agreeing to be part of the study, to the team at Hadassah, who this project wouldn't have been possible without their help, and also to the Garvan team, particularly in the Tangi lab. Like I said, I'm a clinician, so when I first came to the lab, I hadn't held a pipette since first year university, so it had been a long time, so I really needed a bit of help with my basic lab skills. So really thank you to everyone that's made that possible. And finally, you know, we live in an age where everyone likes inspirational quotes, so I thought I would include some. And just a picture from one of my favourite books, The Little Prince, about, you know, as adults, we see things, you know, in their most obvious sort of incarnation. You know, we see the hat, whereas young children look at, you know, what might also be possible, which is, you know, the elephant inside the boa constrictor. So to always, I guess, think outside the box and keep some of that investigative wonder about us. So thank you.